Good day. Greetings from Tokyo. Welcome to ADBI Featured Speaker Webinar. I'm delighted to introduce today's featured speaker, Dr. Peter Fowler, a senior counsel for enforcement in the Office of Policy and International Affairs at the United States Patent and Trade Office, or USPTO. During his over 20 years at the USPTO, Dr. Fowler played other important roles as well, including regional intellectual property attaché for Southeast Asia, working on range of intellectual property enforcement and the training and capacity building programs. Previously, he served as an advisor to the Office of the United States Trade Representative on a number of trade agreement negotiations. He received his JD from Golden Gate University School of Law. As the COVID-19 health crisis subsides, economic recovery will shift into high gear in the Asia-Pacific region through digital transformation and fourth industrial revolution. Even during the crisis, e-commerce and the digital trade have been on the rise, and interest in green growth has been increasing in the region. In the coming recovery process, there will be further digital transformation, transition from fossil to renewable energy, together with technology progress, technological progress that reduces the cost of transition. And we will see numerous products and the process innovations that make our economies more circular. Today, Dr. Fowler will provide his insights into the increasing importance of intellectual property right protection and enforcement in the region in facilitating job creation and innovation. He will explain the role played by USPTO's partnership with the region's national intellectual property offices in building intellectual property protection and enforcement. I stop here. Dr. Fowler, thank you very much for joining us. After your speech, we will have panel discussion. Dr. Fowler, you have about 15 minutes. Now the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Dean Sanobe, both for the kind introduction and also the very kind invitation to join you all for this discussion about the state of intellectual property, or IP, protection and enforcement in Asia and the Pacific. It's also a distinct honor to have the opportunity to talk with the ADBI community about IP in the context of trade, competition, and innovation. And I think the Dean knows how much I like to talk about IP. So in discussing IP in the Asia-Pacific region, it would, of course, be ideal to do what Rodgers and Hammerstein advised in The Sound of Music, to start at the very beginning, a very good place to start. And while historians have tried, it's nearly impossible to pinpoint exactly when and where the first concepts of protection for IP arose. But one can argue that it is actually in this region that the concept of IP can be said to have first emerged. As far back as 5000 BCE in China, identification of owner or artisan marks were required on pottery and ceramics. Yet the concept also emerged as an aspect of other cultures and societies. In ancient Egypt, craftsmen would include unique images and signs on their products for recognition by consumers. In 12th century England, jewelers were prohibited from selling their creations unless each piece included a stamp from the Goldsmiths Hall in London, which became later known as a hallmark. And the requirement was taken very seriously. The act of creating a counterfeit hallmark was punishable by death. In Europe over the 13th to 16th centuries, a merchant mark was used by merchants and traders on their wares. It's considered the earliest form of a modern trademark, serving as an identifier of source and a guarantee of quality for goods, the same basis of modern trademark law. As for copyright, the earliest recorded case law on the right to copy involved a copy of the Cathach of St. Columba. That was the earliest known example of Irish writing. And around 560 AD, a dispute arose over the ownership of the only existing handwritten copy. And I do mean dispute, as it led to the Battle of Cool Dream, notable for being not only the earliest known armed conflict over copyright in the world, but thankfully, we hope, the only one. The dispute was settled when King Diarmaid MacCarraville ruled that to every cow belongs her calf. Therefore, to every book belongs its copy. It's not as poetic as Solomon, perhaps, but it captured the concept of an author's right to control copies of the original work. And it did bring about the end of the bloodshed. While modern copyright law has been influenced by an array of legal rights recognized throughout history, the moral rights of the author, economic rights, personal property rights even, as well as a sovereign's right to censor and regulate the printing industry, it was actually the invention of movable type and the Gutenberg printing press that forced governments to enact laws regulating copyright. The English Statute of Anne in 1710 and later similar laws in the various Low Countries and German states brought copyright issues to the public policy realm, and the eventual expansion of copyright protection to additional forms of expression over the years, including the visual arts, literary and musical words, cartography, choreography, architectural works, computer software, and even most recently to AI-generated content. As for patents, the earliest recorded reference was a patent granted in 1421 to a Florence architect who developed a crane system for shipping and transporting marble. In 1449, a Flemish glassmaker, John Utinam, was the first person to be granted a patent in England, which gave him exclusive rights for 20 years to produce stained glass. That was a technology that was, until that point, unknown in England. And the term of protection, 20 years, is now the WTO mandated norm. However, it was in 1474 when the Venetian Senate articulated the modern concept of intellectual property by enshrining in a patent law the importance of protection of inventors' rights. As Professor Craig Nard of Case Western Reserve University has astutely observed, the Venetian Act was a huge breakthrough legally. It contained the fundamental principles of our modern patent system. And while patents were bestowed by the English court as part of a patronage system on well-established techniques or commodities during the reigns of Elizabeth I and James I, by 1624, Parliament, responding to growing complaints about the abuse and corruption in the practice, enacted the Statute of Monopolies and transferred patent administration to the common civil courts. In effect, they were saying, as a matter of public policy, patents are fine and needed, but you have to grant them for inventions that are actually novel and not as a result of favoritism to those in the favor of the court. In the United States, the 1787 Constitution laid the basis for granting patent rights to inventors and copyright owners. The framers viewed such protections as critically important to incentivize industrial growth in the new agrarian nation of the United States. Now, while major legislative overhauls of the US IP laws have expanded protection and enforcement, numerous US Supreme Court decisions have played an important role in clarifying the scope of IP rights. For example, the 1980 decision in Diamond versus Chakrabarty, which held that genetically modified living organisms could be patented, provided the legal underpinnings for the entire US biotech industry. In 1995, the WTO Agreement on Trade-Related Aspects of Intellectual Property Rights, or TRIPS as it's called, formally linked compliance with minimum protection and enforcement standards with international trade, resulting in the subsequent and ongoing adoption of IP laws around the world by WTO member economies. The inclusion of IP provisions in bilateral, regional, and plurilateral trade agreements, including the Comprehensive and Progressive Trans-Pacific Partnership and the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, both of which are particularly relevant to the Asia-Pacific region, is now an uncontroversial given. Finally, the confluence of digital technology, the internet, and growth of the World Wide Web has brought about the creation of a global digital market, increasing e-commerce and global communications, information dissemination, and entertainment content availability and distribution. Taken together, this has accelerated the need for economies to put into place enhanced IP laws and provide the resources for better IP administration and effective enforcement. But I suspect that the real interest for the ADBI community is not about the history of IP, but rather, do IP laws lead to economic growth? It is, of course, a question that a number of economists have tackled. In 1997, Park and Hinarte proposed an index for IPR, which attempted to give a quantitative score to a country's level of IP protection. Using this index, they provided an examination of the relationship between patent protection and long-run economic growth for 60 countries for the period over 1960 to 1990, later extended to 2005 in a subsequent study by Park. The results of their work showed that strong IP rights do not contribute to economic growth simply by being codified into law, but rather by increasing investment possibilities, with such investments then being associated with the stimulation of long-term growth. Similarly, in another 1997 study, Gould and Grubin also identified an indirect effect of IP rights on GDP. Their conclusion? Strong patent protection leads to improvements in factor accumulation, which in turn has an influence on economic growth. In 2016, the U.S. Department of Commerce report, Intellectual Property in the U.S. Economy, found that IP-intensive industries support at least 45 million U.S. jobs and contribute more than $6 trillion U.S. dollars to, or more than 38% of, U.S. GDP. And I suspect the importance of IP to the U.S. economy has only continued to grow since then. The World Intellectual Property Organization, in its Global Innovation Index, provides detailed metrics about the innovation performance of 131 countries and economies around the world. Its 80 indicators explore a broad vision of innovation, including political environment, education, infrastructure, and business sophistication. As WIPO has noted, strong IPR protections are associated with increased private sector R&D, higher levels of innovation, greater high-value sector job creation, and more promotion and commercialization of cutting-edge clinical research. Finally, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Global Innovation Policy Center releases an annual international IP index, which benchmarks the IPR framework in 53 global markets, representing over 90% of global GDP. It also evaluates the ecosystem in each economy across 50 unique indicators, which industry believes represent economies with the most effective IPR systems, and it serves as a roadmap for policymakers who seek to support innovation, creativity, and economic growth through more robust IP policy. Taken together, these various indices provide excellent insight into the role of IP in innovation and the impact that IP has on economies. The theme for the 2017 International IP Index was the roots of innovation. And given the direct correlation between the strength of a nation's IPR regime and economic growth, it was an apt metaphor. As successful gardeners know, it's all about the roots. Without a strong root structure and adequate water, most trees and plants do not survive. And without tackling those constantly threatening unfair competitors, pesky weeds and pests, even beautiful gardens will be at risk of being overgrown, becoming unproductive, or wasting away. One could say the same for economies. Absent a strong IPR structure and responsive enforcement mechanisms, an economy that wants to grow and thrive will face a harsh future in the modern global climate of trade and competition. Moreover, much like Hollywood or Bollywood stars, there is the constant threat to one's reputation. Country branding is a real thing. A country having a reputation for producing genuine, high-quality goods can leverage that cachet in the minds of consumers. Think Switzerland or Germany, for example. On the other hand, a country that becomes associated with its exports of shoddy, fake, and substandard quality goods may face steep odds of convincing the world's consumers otherwise. Some observers view a country's trademark and patent application volume as a proxy for the intensity of its brand creation and innovation. And although numerical comparisons may relate in some measure to its intensity in these areas, conclusions should be reached without considering the effect of non-market factors. They should not be reached, I'm sorry, without considering the effect of non-market factors such as government mandates and subsidies, bad faith trademark applications, and resulting countermeasures, which substantially contribute to trademark and patent application activity. Absent consideration of the role of non-market factors, cross-border comparisons based on simply looking at the raw number of trademark and patent applications risk overstating brand creation and innovation activity. In addition, these non-market factors may also be undermining domestic and foreign IP registries, stretching the capacity of national patent and trademark examiners and review authorities, and narrowing the scope of available protection for legitimate rights holders. As I noted in a recent commentary for the National Bureau of Asian Research, the ASEAN Working Group on IP Cooperation is currently in the process of taking stock of its progress in fulfilling its commitments by 2025 to drive economic prosperity in the region through greater IP creation, innovation, and the attraction of substantial foreign direct investments in R&D. Director General Raul Barba of the IP Office of the Philippines, who recently assumed the chair of the group, has stated his desire to accelerate the completion of remaining deliverables under the ASEAN IP Rights Action Plan 2016 to 2025. He envisions doing this by enabling more cooperation activities within the bloc and with ASEAN dialogue partners. And in his words, uniting the ASEAN community with the goal of improving the IP system for economic recovery and growth. According to DG Barba, 82% of the action plan is either ongoing or completed. But I think it's fair to say that the commitments that remain are both sensitive and a bit politically challenging. They include exploring the establishment of unified regional IP systems, creating databases to consolidate genetic resources, traditional knowledge, and copyright information, strengthening the financial basis and management of members' national IP offices, and developing an information exchange and effective guidelines on enforcement against online infringement of IP. While completing the outstanding task will be a challenge, the goal of regional economic integration is laudable and should be widely supported. Yet its success depends on the harmonization of IP norms and practices across the region. As individual countries implement policies and initiatives to expand trade, attract investment, open their markets, and promote innovation, the potential positive influence on regional IP protection and enforcement efforts cannot be discounted and will likely gain support from the business and innovation-oriented community. If WIPO is correct that innovation, invention is the bedrock of innovation, and that viable invention depends on a robust patent system, then countries in the region, especially in the Pacific part of Asia Pacific, will need to consider how to move forward in renovating their IP systems to meet the expectations of innovative investors and gain the approval of global innovation arbiters. Given the disparity of economic levels, resources, variations of legal systems, and cultural attitudes about the value of IP to national economic development, this may prove a hard path to navigate. Efforts at harmonization to date have been basic and incremental. Even initiatives that would significantly benefit IP applicants have sometimes proved hard to achieve or prioritize. Practices vary among countries, of course, and the least developed economies in the region may not feel pressured to take dramatic action in the absence of vocal demands from domestic constituencies. Yet even if the prospect for greater harmonization looks brighter, the efficient resolution of disputes over IP remains a challenge, especially in the courts. While some countries in the region have created specialized courts or implemented special rules for IP disputes, others have not. So the litigation of IP disputes may prove to be a barrier to timely and efficient resolution of commercial IP disputes. Unlike other regions with a common market framework, the EU, the Andes PAC, the CARICOM, the AEC has no pact or treaty to provide for a supranational appellate body to decide IP disputes where national courts interpret IP laws differently within a single market. Not surprisingly, IP rights holders will want to see their IP treated the same throughout a single market economy. But without a supranational judicial organ, rights holders will be left to the uncertainties of individual national judicial bodies in protecting and enforcing their IP. As Thai economists Narongchai Akrasani and Jutamas Arunandanchai once noted in comparing ASEAN and the EU, while embracing all aspects of the EU institution is politically unfeasible and unnecessary, a supranational ASEAN court is the one thing that the ASEAN economic integration process cannot do without. More than two decades after making that salient observation, their point is still valid, I think. While there has been greater levels of intra-regional cooperation by law enforcement agencies in investigating and prosecuting transnational IP crime, fully harmonized and integrated transnational enforcement, let alone an integrated judicial system, may seem a bridge too far. Yet the success of the EU in creating regional enforcement mechanism demonstrates that it is both feasible and of economic value. In the Pacific region, the USPTO is currently working with the Oceania Customs Organization on a project to harmonize the IP laws and border measures among a number of its member territories with an eye towards the long-term goal of establishing a regional IP administration. Lessons might be gleaned also from the experiences of the African Union, which with 54 members faces a challenge in building a common commitment to regional harmonization and in facilitating establishment of a continental IP body, the Pan-African Intellectual Property Organization and EU, the African Union, is moving in line with its vision for regional integration. As Professor Yukai Wupangafundu of the University of the Western Cape in South Africa has noted, African countries have adopted regional integration as a strategy to deal with the challenges of globalization, firmly believing that this will increase their negotiating capacity and competitiveness in global trade, as well as improve access to foreign technology. The Asia-Pacific region is a challenging yet promising environment. So looking forward, where is the region headed? The IP landscape includes a range of IP legal regimes, some still emerging, modern and sophisticated in others. Yet the overall trajectory of progress on IP is clear. The region is a dynamo of trade and manufacturing, with R&D-based industries and high-tech commerce finding a ready home and online commerce expanding exponentially. And it is a magnet for investors and innovators, and it will likely continue to be for the foreseeable future. But to realize its full potential, greater harmonization of IP regimes, expanded public awareness and education about the benefits of IP to economic growth, and more effective proactive enforcement of IP should be the highest priorities for policymakers. I want to thank you very much for the opportunity to share with you some of my thoughts. And now I believe we'll have some questions.
Okay, so let's start the panel discussion. We have several panelists. Here is Peter Morgan and Linda Arthur and Dion Ukli and Dina Azgarieva. So which order? Maybe Linda, would you unmute and then start asking questions or comments?
Thank you very much, Dean, and thank you very much, Dr. Fowler, for your very interesting presentation. And the historical overview was particularly interesting, actually. So thanks for that. But just taking this more into the latter part of your discussion about developing economies, we know that in the last, certainly in the last 20 years or more, subsequent to particular legislation in the US, that patents have become quite numerous and have increased dramatically. And not only is there an increase, but patents have become more upstream and also wider. Now, in developing countries, particularly the poorest, it's very important that these countries can access knowledge, open knowledge, and access it to sort of adapt that knowledge to their own circumstances. And their economic growth is sort of built on this until such time as they develop their own capability to make, you know, knowledge of their own. So my question to you is that since it's so important for developing countries to access knowledge in the public domain, is knowledge becoming less accessible over time as intellectual property rights increase, become more upstream and wider, and thereby narrowing crucial knowledge flows for less developed countries to innovate and grow their economies?
Thank you for the question. And let me preface all my remarks by saying I am not a patent expert. My field of expertise is copyright and entertainment law and education. And so I don't hold myself out as a patent expert, but I've sort of studied as a historian the patent system. And one of the great features of the patent system, the trade-off, if you will, for the exclusive rights and the monopoly that's been granted, is the fact that the information, the technical information that underlies the invention, must be made public, must be published. And that sharing of information allows others to see what is being invented. It allows them to, as everybody from Bill Gates to Elon Musk has said, to stand on the shoulders of giants in various technologies and to go further. So I'm not sure that with the requirement in all patent systems around the world that publication is a crucial component of the patent system. I'm not sure I totally agree with the idea that there's a restriction or restraint on knowledge that is hampering other countries. One could argue that in some areas, and some technologies, that the preference to rely on trade secret protection, at least certainly in the early stages, or depending on the development of particular new technologies. One could argue that that is a restriction on broad distribution of knowledge, but the IP system allows that if it is proprietary information that's been developed, and that's a broad, at least in the US, that covers a broad range of information. Then that's the choice of the creator, the inventor, to do that, or to opt for going into the patent system for a limited term patent. It's a trade-off. I think this often comes up in the context of technology transfer. And I don't believe that there's really huge impediments on, as you said, the development of knowledge, I think educational systems play such a crucial role in opening up areas where the more inventive, scientific-minded will be able to, you know, flourish. You know, one of the I think critical components of the higher educational system is not only a broad underlying feeder basis, if you will, of STEM education across the board throughout from starting early in grade school, primary school, and up through to colleges and universities, but also the support that needs to be given and the resources devoted to a strong scientific research, both basic and practical, as well as engineering and other types of technological-based education. You don't see that everywhere. You know, I'm reminded of what the General Counsel of Intel once told me about Vietnam, because Intel, of course, was one of the first huge investors in Vietnam. And many have followed since based on sort of a taking the cue from Intel. But he said, if he could just wave a wand and have 4,000 to 5,000 more engineers a year come out of the educational system of Vietnam, he would be fine. But they struggle to find enough educated engineers that they would readily hire. So I think the educational system in a developing country, and certainly a least developed country, plays a unique role.
Okay, thank you
very much. If there's time, I'll come back to that. But
okay. So I'd like to ask Yong-wook and Dina, but before that, I'd like to request other participants, please write your question in the Q&A box. Okay, now Yong-wook and then Dina, please ask questions. So Yong-wook first.
Thank you very much, Dean. And thank you for your insightful presentation, Dr. Fowler. I would like to ask you on relationship between patents and innovation. Generally, patents are considered to be essential tools in driving innovation by granting incentives for innovators. However, there are many empirical research that patents are not the most efficient instrument to innovate, considering a lot of costs with litigation costs and license fees, as well as infrastructure costs to manage the patents system. As you know, IP environment of Asian developing countries is still weak. Momentum to prioritize IP policy and mobilize enough resources to make a strong patent system is needed. I think it depends on the role of patents on innovation. Do you confirm that patents are the cost-effective tools to drive innovation? And if the current patent system fails to promote innovation in Asian developing countries, what should they do to reform the patent system to drive innovation? That's my question.
Thank you. It's a loaded question. I think I have to tread lightly here. I have some colleagues back in my agency who may take offense at whatever I say. Either way, but I think there's the clear connection between innovation and the patent system. I'm not an economist. I don't even claim to be one. And I think but looking at the studies that economists have done, including our own chief economist at the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, I certainly am persuaded that the patent system and provides certain opportunities and is valuable in certain ways in spurring innovation. Can it be costly? Yes, it can be. And I think there's also a recognition that, of course, the US patent system, for example, is very wide open, very accommodating. The general attitude is that one would be entitled to a patent if you can prove and provide all the basis for getting it. So it's not the kind of attitude or culture at the USPTO that discourages patenting. On the contrary, we encourage patenting of inventions as much as possible. That said, there is no promise that every single patent is going to be commercially successful. And in fact, a very large majority of inventors who file and obtain patents in the US for a myriad of reasons do not become billionaires or even millionaires because of their patented inventions. Either they are themselves not good business people, that's a possibility. Perhaps their invention is too much of a niche invention. It doesn't really have a lot of commercial possibilities. There's also, I think, a long history of very interesting inventors who were simply ahead of the curve. They simply invented something and obtained a patent on a invention for which there just simply was not a current interest or market. And they were unable to really fully realize the potential. There certainly have been patents that were granted. At the time, they served a certain, you know, they sat on the shelf, in effect. And only later, did they become the inspiration or the building block for other inventors looking at that technology and going further? The best example that there can be, I think, in that respect, or at least one of the more glamorous ones, is the inventor Hedy Lamarr, who was a Hollywood actress. She was German by birth. She became an American citizen. And during World War II, when President Roosevelt called on the nation to help with the war effort, she and a co-inventor friend of hers came up with the basis for the alternating frequencies and being able to invent something that ended up becoming the basis for sonar and radar. Later, others have said, Musk and others have attributed that it was also the basis decades later for the concept of Wi-Fi. Hedy Lamarr died, she was a successful actress, but she never made any money on an invention that now people look back and say was a technological breakthrough. She just simply was ahead of her time. Mm-hmm. So I'll leave it at that. It's better addressed, I think, your question at its root by economists.
Thank you very much. Very interesting example. Okay, now Dina, your turn.
Thank you, Dean Sanobe. Thank you, Peter, for taking us through the history of intellectual property rights and explaining how intellectual property affects economic growth through investments, right? So I'm interested in the climate change mitigation technologies. I think IP is very important for development of technologies like renewable energy, energy efficiency, like carbon capture and storage or energy storage, right? Those are still developing and we're looking for technologies which will help to improve cost or safety, something, yes, to make it cheaper. Yeah, so I noticed that number of innovations or patents mainly in developed countries and not so much in developing, for example, developing Asia. I wonder if you can have suggestions, what are the drivers or barriers for for bringing investments or patents for innovations in climate change mitigation technologies?
Very good question, thank you. And I think a lot of leading patent offices in the world, the IP5, the five largest, have worked very closely together to develop programs and initiatives to try to accelerate the patenting of innovations in the area of climate change, environmental protection, and other types of patents. The US has the Patents for Humanity, which are different categories of patents that we accelerate the process. We waive fees and we move them very quickly through the system. Other offices, the UK Patent Office, the JPO, the Korean Patent Office, and many others have similar types of programs. In the area of green technology, the USPTO has also move forward to try to accelerate. I think this is because we've seen that investors are interested in available patents. And in many developing countries, it can take years and years and years to get a patent on what could be a very insightful and impactful invention. But there are some countries where filing the patent application may not come with too much cost, but it sits and sits and sits. It may take 7, 8, 10, I don't want to criticize particular IP offices because, my office works with all of them and we try to support in terms of technology training and technical assistance and, capacity building. But when it takes, when I was an IP attaché in Southeast Asia, based in Bangkok, there were patent offices in the region that would take as long as 18 or 19 years to issue a patent in some sectors, technology sectors. Now, when the entire term of protection is only 20 years from date of application, what good is a patent to the inventor or the investors when they maybe have a year or 2 years at the most left on the term? So one of the things that we've tried to work just consistently with globally is moving the patent examination process more speedily. That doesn't mean sacrificing quality. It means simplifying processes and examination steps. The patent prosecution highway that we in Japan and Korea and many other countries have utilized globally has been successful in that, in which it allows patent offices working with the same application in different offices to jointly move that patent forward. We've also expanded, as have other major offices, patent validation agreements. In other words, if an invention has already been granted a patent in one of the major IP patent offices in the world, the question arises, why should then every developing country reinvent the wheel by examining it again and again and again, when in many cases they will not even have the level of expertise for examination that the JPO or KIPO or the USPTO or the EPO have. It's a struggle for even the most major patent offices to keep abreast of constantly changing cutting edge technology for examination purposes. It is impossible. And I hate to sound so, definitive in this respect, but frankly, it is impossible for most developing countries to ever, ever get a handle and devote the kinds of resources to patent examination. It would be better if there is a limited number of engineers in the country, they would be better put to use in the private sector than being hired as government patent examiners, frankly. So okay. I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. So before opening up the floor, I'd like to ask another Peter Molnar, for the question.
Yes, so thanks very much for an excellent presentation. I was quite fascinated in particular by your last point about the capacity of the patent examination offices in developing countries. And I'm just wondering, is this an issue that's being considered, for example, at the ASEAN level? Or are you aware of any other kind of cooperative or attempts to address this issue?
Oh, absolutely. It's being addressed, both patents and trademarks, at the capacity building level. The USPTO was actually the first US federal agency to establish a formal working relationship partnership and under an MOU with the ASEAN Secretariat and the ASEAN Working Group on IP Cooperation. We were followed later by the Japan Patent Office and the European Patent Office and the what was at the time the European OHIM, Office of Harmonization in the Internal Market. They've rebranded themselves as the EU IPO now. All of us, and including IP Australia and Singapore's IP office, conduct a lot of capacity building and training in the ASEAN region and in the broader Asia Pacific region. We do probably 10 to 12 programs a year, ranging anywhere from patent and trademark examination training, copyright, cutting copyright issues, enforcement of IP in different ways. And I think all of us, speaking for all of the donor agencies, have been very active in Asia regarding trying to build the capacity in the national IP offices. Would we love to see, and have we supported in the past, a possible regional IP administration for the ASEAN economic community? The short answer is yes. We would both like to see it, and we supported it in the past. For whatever reasons at the time, the ASEAN Working Group on IP Cooperation did not follow through on that, but that's back on the table now. And it's actually one of the unfinished businesses to be addressed now under the current ASEAN IP plan for action through 2025. We are fully supportive of it. And I would say that from my experience, the IP owners community and brand owners, patent owners, et cetera, around the world are also extremely supportive of such a regional IP approach.
Okay. Thank you very much. So thank you very much for the interesting panel discussion. Yeah, because of the time limitation, we have to move on the next section, which is about Q&A. So already three questions are in the Q&A box. I'd like to ask John to moderate this last session.
Yes, thank you very much. We now have around 10 minutes for Q&A. There's still time to ask more questions if you wish. I could just reflect two of the questions directly now to Dr. Fowler. So first of all, there's a question from Kathmandu, Nepal, and the issue here is around this sustaining innovation. And I suppose this relates to what particularly the developing economies can do in the face of high enforcement costs associated with IP and how they ensure that they don't fall behind in this respect in terms of innovation progress. The second question, so that's one. The second question is on your views on IP and patents for public goods. This is a question by Sitaram from ADBI. For example, vaccines or other medicines that are essentially globally public health or water treatment or technologies for safe sanitation. So what are your views on IP for those types of public goods?
Okay, I'll take the second question first and say that the US strongly supports intellectual property rights. Globally, under the WTO and the TRIPS agreement, there are provisions that allow for certain exceptions in certain circumstances. And that is, in terms of the application to, say, for example, vaccines, that's currently under discussion and negotiation in Geneva. So I really am in no position to speak about that. In terms of the costs of enforcement of IP, a number of countries have been, I think, very innovative and creative in attempting to look at options. And this is the US as well is doing this. We just last December, our Congress finally got around to enacting a small claims board approach for copyright infringement. And our Congress has recently written to the USPTO and asked us to renew our study and research and make recommendations to the US Senate as to whether this should be extended and establish a small claims court approach for patents. It does exist in the UK, for example, already. Other countries have used administrative enforcement to deal with what I would consider small cases of infringement between individuals or small businesses. Vietnam actually has a very extensive administrative enforcement system. And I think also the extension of commercial arbitration and mediation to IP disputes can actually address many of the costs of enforcing or resolving disputes over IP infringement. So there are ways, I think, to approach that, even for developing countries.
Okay, thank you very much. I have a follow-up question from myself. So I think the issue of patent reform is pertinent to what you have just said. I think in the past, long patent durations were a feature in this area, and there may be some argument that the patent duration should be shorter. I wonder what your view on that is, to enable basically more wider dispersion of the knowledge.
Again, I'm not a patent expert, so I'd hesitate to give you a definitive opinion in that. I will just say, from sort of a political standpoint, I would question that such an approach is even feasible at the global level. It took a lot of negotiation in the Marrakesh round to achieve the TRIPS agreement. It is delicately balanced between the desires and needs of developed and developing and least developed countries. There were significant trade-offs that were made at the time of those negotiations to craft it. I think there is little or no appetite. Again, I'll say this is my personal view. There's little or no appetite to go back and reopen the TRIPS agreement for renegotiation of patent terms. I think that's the reality. Yeah. So I know that there's been people and commentators and even some inventors who have said, you know, a 20-year term for patents for everything, you know, is maybe not workable. It's the same kind of argument as whether or not a single term of life of the author plus 70 is a workable term for copyright. But it is what the trend is. It's what the majority of countries in the world have adopted. It's probably not going to change anytime soon.
Okay, many thanks. Just one other question from my side. So what are your views on the issue of FDI and using this as a way to obtain technology? So essentially acquiring companies for the purpose of obtaining technology via the IP. And is that something that's apparent in some regions compared to others, for example, or particular sectors compared to others?
Well, you know, the idea of collecting companies based on their IP portfolios is actually nothing new. You know, there's various different terms that are bandied around as to what they are called these days. Non-practicing entities, for example, some would say trolls, others. But actually, at least from the U.S. historical perspective, this is what basically Alexander Graham Bell and Thomas Edison did by consolidating their portfolios of patents. And then they use that as a basis for licensing. One could argue that it's actually an efficient way rather than having to deal with many, many, many individual inventors or rights holders. So there may be, again, I'm not an economist and I don't play one on TV, but maybe an economist would see that as a more efficient way to deal with a licensing system for IP.
Okay, thank you very much. Before we come to the close, I would like to ask if any of the panelists have one quick question to ask. If yes, please indicate that you do. Dina, please, one final question. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Yeah, you told so many interesting stories about intellectual property rights and patents. I'm wondering if there is a database which we can check and which would be useful for researchers.
A database as to interesting patents. Stories or?
No, patents for patents, yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, of course, there's many databases. The largest one is the one that's administered by WIPO, that almost every member state of WIPO and has access to. That's probably the most comprehensive database of patents. There are Google also has an extensive database. The U.S. patent system and virtually all the other major offices in the world contribute to it. So a lot of that is brought about because of the current technology of not only digitizing all this stuff, but making it available worldwide. I'm reminded of, you know, the one last story, one historical story. During the Meiji Restoration period, the Japanese sent a delegation to the United States to study the US patent system. They stayed at the patent office for 3 months, reviewing and handwriting all of the patents that they could copy. And then they went later on to the UK and to Germany to study their patent systems. They went back to Japan after about a year going around the world, and they made all kinds of recommendations to the Japanese government to adopt a patent law and a patent office. And they said, The one single thing that they concluded after their year worth of study and research was that the patent system was critical for Japan to industrialize and become a modern state. I think that lesson is still valid.
Thank you very much, Peter, for your excellent insights today. We've come to the close very punctually at 11 o'clock in Tokyo. So with that, this webinar is now concluded.
Thank you
very much to everybody who has participated and for the questions received. And as was outlined at the start, the video will become online over the next week or so. So keep a look on our webpage for that. Thank you very much.
And
goodbye.
Thank you.